Good morning, everyone. It's good to be with you. My name is Larry Geisler, as Rod said. I've been here before, so you might have seen me in recent weeks. I've been here to do communion and just some hosting, and actually my wife, Stephanie, used to be a part of this campus, her and her sister, Lindsay, so you might know them from a few years back, but either way, Corey's in Aruba with his wife, having a good time celebrating their 30th wedding anniversary, I think, so... Yeah, just when, isn't that cool? So when they come back, make sure you say, man, I hope you had a great time. Like, let them talk about their vacation to you because that's such an important thing for somebody who's given so many years to ministry to get away, celebrate his marriage and all that God has done in them. But either way, I'm selfishly grateful that I get to be here with you guys today. So I need to preface with, if I at some point happen to pass out, it is because on Friday night, I had an all-night event with our junior high students. And the reason I'm saying this, there's junior hires in the room. You could be a part of this next year. You could do this. It's our junior high all-nighter, and we, from 6 p.m. to 9 a.m., we're up with a bunch of junior high students at main event at our Elgin campus playing gaga ball and video games all through the night, and so us pastors, we have to keep an eye on everyone, so we didn't sleep. So it's not a medical condition. If I happen to, you know, fall on the ground, it's just purely, my body doesn't know what it's doing. So, but I am really grateful to open up God's Word this morning. So you're going to need a Bible. We're in Matthew chapter 6. We're continuing this deeply rooted series, and we're talking about prayer. But I wanted to talk to you about one of these things that I learned at this junior high all-nighter. It was kind of important. So we do something called the impossible shot. And the point of this shot is that it is, from my perspective, probably impossible. But we give a pretty good prize if you make the impossible shot. For students, we wanted to give them a brand new pair of like $150 Air Force Ones. If you make the impossible shot, you get the shoes that everyone wants. You're gonna look cool. You would never have money in your junior high wallet to pay for this. Like, it's a great reward. Now, here's what they had to do. Now, imagine, we're in our Elgin campus, so imagine all the way back above this little balcony, all the way in the top of the room is a stack of cups, and there's a ping pong ball on top of the cups. They have to shoot a styrofoam arrow all the way across the room, like 100 yards up in the corner, hit the cups, pop the ping pong ball perfectly off the cups to where it falls about 50 feet to the floor into a cup that's sitting on the floor. Does that sound possible? I don't think that it is. But let me tell you how many students all night are lined up to take shots at the impossible shot over and over and over again. Nobody even hit the cups. And that's the easy part. Nobody even hit the cups the whole night, and yet they continue to try. Wow. Humans. We are very motivated by incentives. We're super motivated by rewards. If there's a great reward at the end of something, we go to some pretty great lengths. We grind it out pretty hard so that we can get this reward. We want to be rewarded. So the question is it worth it? All the effort that goes into whatever it is that you're seeking for, that reward, is it worth it? And if everything can be traced back to incentive or reward, what is it that's driving us? What is it that's motivating us when it comes to the Christian life? What is it that's motivating us to come to church? What's motivating us to live a life of character beyond the walls of the church. And specifically, what we're going to be talking about today is, what is it that motivates us to pray? What's the reason that we do this? That we would gather in a room like this and spend time to pray? That we would, on our own, sit and what people who don't understand what we are doing think that we're just talking out into nothing? What is the incentive? What is the reason? Why do we or do we not pray in certain circumstances over other circumstances? Why do certain things in our life just drive us to prayer? Where and when do we find it more worth it to pray? And what is the reason for us thinking this way? We all have a framework. This is how I pray. This is when I pray. It's at church, it's before the meal, it's in the morning. Why is it this way? And is there maybe a greater reward to be found in our prayers? A greater reward to communion with God than we've been allowing ourselves, because we force our life of prayer to fit into this little framework that we've built for it. It has to fit into my church gatherings. It has to fit into the amount of time that I have before work or school in the morning. Is there a greater reward to be found in prayer? And so we're going to open up our Bibles to Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to start at verse 5. You might be familiar. This is the Lord's Prayer. This is the words of Jesus. And who better to listen to when it comes to figuring out what it means to pray to God, the purpose we pray to God, than God himself, instructing us on what is the heart of prayer, what should be the reward that we're seeking in prayer, what should be the reason we're doing this, and what are some of the ways that we're getting it wrong? What are some of the places we're missing the point? And so I want to read these first two verses, starting in verse 5. Here's what Jesus says. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. So I want to pause there. Who are the people that Jesus is talking about? He's talking about the person who prays in the synagogues. That's a pretty spiritual person, right? And you would think about who's the person who prays in front of the church when the church gathers together. Who's that person? Flav, man, spiritual guy. Because he prays for the church. He prays in front of the church. That takes a spiritual person to do that. Think about the street preacher who's preaching on the street corners. They're drawing a lot of attention to themselves. You say, wow, I mean, I don't know if I agree with their methods maybe, or maybe you do, but they're devoted. But Jesus says something really interesting. That he says they're hypocrites, meaning they do one thing, they say another. So these are these kinds of people, but he says that they're receiving a reward. That seems opposite. It's obvious that Jesus is telling us not to be like them. Actually, that's how he starts the next verse. He says, do not be like them, but they are receiving a reward. What is this reward to be had? In spiritual things, like prayer, that would be found even if you're doing it for the totally wrong motivation. Even if you're the person that has found a place in a position of authority in a church, and you're there for the wrong reason? Well, because there's a type of worldly recognition, worldly power, worldly fame, worldly authority that every single one of us are drawn to. Who doesn't like to be affirmed for the things that they're doing? Who doesn't like a pat on the back and say, you are a great pastor, or you are a great friend, or you are a great follower of Jesus? But that praise is purely based on the words that you speak in public and are not grounded in the life that you live in secret. And so Jesus is bringing this to the surface when he's talking to the disciples. Look, all these people you see that look good on the outside, they do the right things. They pray the right prayers, but they're hypocrites. They've gotten their reward, and that's fine, but don't be like them. Now, if they're receiving a good reward, why not be like them? Why not be drawn into that incentive? That if I carry myself a certain way and pray in certain ways around people, that I'm going to be regarded highly. Why not give in to that reward? Well, because Jesus is telling us all there is a greater reward. There is something far better than all the recognition in the world. There is something better than the greatest position of authority. And Jesus is going to tell us to choose the greater reward. And here's what he's talking about. Verse 6. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. So there is a reward to be had in our prayers. There is a reward to be had in our time with God that has nothing to do with the church. There is something for you to find in the presence of God that doesn't even have to do with whether you were here this morning or not. Now, it is very important that you're here this morning, so don't hear that you shouldn't value and love and be a part of the church. But the church is not the place that you find God. You do not wait to gather with the church to find God. You don't wait for your community group in the middle of the week to find God. Because Jesus tells us that there is a reward to be had in secret, where your Father who sees in secret will reward you. So what is this reward? What would be the reward in prayer that you find that has nothing to do with anyone else in your life? So many of the things that we tie value to have to do with our relation to others. A reward would be better relationships in my family. That would be great if I came before God and my family things all got better. That's a great reward. Or my position in my job got better. Boom, that's fantastic. If this was how prayer worked and all of our relationships seemed to work out because we prayed with God, yeah, we'd be drawn to prayer, because that's an easy to see reward. You see the fruit right away. But there's a reward in prayer that doesn't always show itself in your daily life circumstances. Actually, there's a reward in prayer that has nothing to do with circumstances at all. The reward that there is to be had in prayer is God. This is what Jesus is talking about. Your Father, who sees you, that you sought him out. You didn't just come to church. You went to where no one else was. When he talks about this room, go to your room in secret, he means find the most private place that you possibly can so that you can be sure. The reason I'm here, the reason I'm bringing these things to God has nothing to do with the way that somebody else is going to perceive me. It has everything to do with the fact that I need to be with the Lord. That I need to know who he is. That I just need time with him. Because when you have time with him, you have a reward that's unlike any other relationship in your life. You get to experience in a supernatural way being seen by the Almighty God of the universe, being known by the God of the universe, being loved perfectly, being cared for, being convicted of sin that no one else in your life has been willing to point out in you because your Father in heaven loves you, being empowered by his Holy Spirit to do things that you in your own capacity would never have the ability or the boldness to do. Prayer is about knowing God in his complexity, in his sovereignty, in his steadfast love and his faithfulness towards you individually. Where else do we find that? There is nowhere else. There is nowhere else that you can find what you find in secret with God. Psalm 8, verses 1 through 4 says this. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You've set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place. What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? Who are we that God would want to be in the secret and to have communion with just you? Well, there's nothing in us. There's nothing in us that draws God. Romans would say that no one seeks for God. We've all just sinned against him. We've rejected him. He has no reason to want us, but he does. No reason to seek us out, but he does. And that is a reward. To know that this God of the universe, despite all that I've done against him, wants relationship with me. He wants to reveal to me more and more and more each day who he is, how he's working in my life, how he's providing what I need, that I find more and more dependence on him. Why wouldn't we want to do this? Why would we choose anything over having this experience? Over having this time in the secret with God? What could possibly take precedence over this? Why would we only pray with others and reject the opportunity to pray with God in secret? We, in the church, we can very easily, very regularly settle for the lesser reward. Settle for the things that Jesus is saying. This is what the hypocrites do. They pray with others because it's convenient and it keeps an image and it makes you feel like you're doing the right thing. It makes you feel like you're close to God. But then what happens when everything falls apart and all that you have is relationship with other Christians, which is great, but the depth of your relationship with the Lord is lacking? We can often think that we have what we need in our own right. I have it together. I do pray with the church. And everything else is fine, and so I'm just not drawn to the reward of prayer. I had my eyes open to this in a really big way when I was in college. And I saw it in a man that I knew that he had found the reward of knowing God in prayer. And that no amount of worldly recognition, no amount of worldly fame could possibly compare to being seen, known, and loved by the God of the universe. Many of you might know a guy named Francis Chan. He was a megachurch pastor in California. He has written many, many books. He then moved to China to do church planting. His track record, his resume, incredible. And oftentimes, this is the trap that we fall into as believers, as we say, look at that resume. Whew! That is a Christian. That guy, that lady, they got it. They know God. And we're just looking at the things that they've done. We're not looking at anything about their character or how they've spent time with the Lord. We have no idea. And so Francis Chan, I went to Liberty University when I was in college, and he comes and he's speaking at our weekly convocation. And it's a Wednesday morning, and he preached this great message from 1 John about repentance. And if you know Jesus, if you've accepted his gift of salvation, if you have repented of your ways, if you know that Jesus died and rose from the graves, that you could know him, then when you make that decision to follow him, your life should change. You should be more like him. You should not continue in sin. And everyone's like, great message. But if you know, sometimes preachers, they have a little timer in the back. I don't have one today, praise God. And then if they go too long, it'll click down into the red numbers. And they know, all right, I got to wrap it up here or somebody's going to be really ticked off at me and I'm not going to be invited back. So from my angle in the worship center, I could see, okay, he's Francis, you're in the reds. And he knew he was in the reds. And he's like, okay, I got to wrap this up. So he wraps up his sermon and he closes, as most people do, in a prayer. And there was nothing wrong with this prayer. Everyone listening says, amen. Good prayer. We're off living our lives. Now, that night, we had another thing that was optional for students called campus community church, where people who are, you know, really devoted to growing as a disciple and hearing good teaching come to this and then go to small groups after. And so we come, and Francis Chan is there again, and he's going to speak to us. We're like, yes, let's go. And so we come in, there's worship, we're like ready to hear. Francis Chan gets up on the stage and you're just like on the edge of your seat waiting to hear what he's going to say. And he says, I need to apologize. I need to apologize to all of you because this morning I was here and I spoke to you and I closed our message in a prayer because that's what we do. But as I was praying, I was not actually aware of who I was praying to. I was not thinking about the fact that I am coming before the sovereign God of the universe, the one who gave his son to atone for my sins. I'm not thinking about the fact that this is an opportunity for me to talk to him. And so instead, I settled for saying a bunch of words that I knew would be well received by the people in this room and said amen. But I was not really praying. And so he said, what I would like to do instead is to open up this time with real prayer. And he got on his knees on the stage, not rushing, not really even thinking about what anyone would think of what he's doing, because it doesn't matter. What he knew is if I'm going to declare God's word, I need to be with him. And so he prayed in front of thousands of us there, but it was him and the Lord. Even with all those people, it was like a prayer in secret. So how is it that the prayer in secret type prayers make their way into the church gathering prayers, into the community group prayers, into the street corner prayers? How does it get there? Well, because it starts in the secret. And you have to have the prayer in the secret to have the prayer in the church, to have the prayer with a friend, to have the prayer with your spouse even. You have to have those times with the Lord where you just bear it all with him. Because then you'll never be confused of what the reward is. You know, you are fully convinced the thing that I exist for, the thing that I want more than anything else is just to be with God. And so when I get around people, I'm not confused as to why I'm here. I'm not confused as to why this church exists. It's not to have a nice community gathering. It's once again to be with God, but the benefit is I get to be with God now with all of his people. And I've had the time with God on my own, and now I get to have the time with God with all these people, and we get to share it. But the significance of that really only settles in if we've had it here first. We have to choose the greater reward, or we're missing out. So, how? How do I experience God in prayer? What do these prayers look like that I would experience God in that way? And praise God, Jesus gives us a model for how to pray. Now, don't be confused. Even churches will read this prayer, recite this prayer all over the world. But what Jesus is trying to get us to do is not to recite this prayer, but really to give us a posture a direction in order to step into prayer, how to experience God in our prayers. And so if we pick up in verse 7, here's what Jesus said. He said, "And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him." So really quick, Jesus is trying to give us a framework of, look, it does not matter how long you pray. It doesn't matter if you use eloquent words when you pray. It doesn't matter if you sound like you even know what you're saying when you pray, which we're so concerned with so much of the time. It doesn't matter. That stuff is not how you gain the ear of God. You have gained the ear of God by being adopted into his family because he chose you. And because he chose you, you have the ear of the God of the universe, and there's nothing you can do to lose it. There's nothing you can do to gain it. You just have it. So when we pray simply, but we pray sincerely. So it is not about, I have to say these things first so that God will hear these things, or I need to say these things first so that the rest of the church will hear that what I'm saying with these things, or they won't think that I'm crazy for asking this. We pray simply, but we pray sincerely. Meaning I know who I'm speaking to. I know the kind of power he holds. I know what he has done in my life and what he will continue to do in my life. I'm talking to him. And so these words hold power. And I don't need to say a certain phrase to gain that. It just is. So I can pray simply. So Jesus tells us this simply and sincerely going into our prayers. And he says, pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Now you've probably heard this 10 billion times. Some of you heard this before. What does this word, hallowed, mean? It means, let God's name be kept holy or be made holy. Not that it isn't holy, it obviously is. But it's communicating this, let God be seen as holy. Let God be revered. Or let God be seen for who he is. And so this is the first thing. This is the first thing that is important for us as a posture of prayer. When we're going into prayer, here's the first thing I need to have my mind set on. When I come to the Lord, I need to see him for who he is. This is the first thing. See God for who he is. Because when you see who he is, when you see the depth of his character, when you see all the things that we talked about before, that he holds the stars in place, that he made the heavens and the earth, that he has a steadfast and faithful love for you, when you see how he's providentially working out everything in your life for your good, when you see him for who he is, you can't be disappointed. When you read his word and you come to him in prayer and he ministers to you through his spirit, you cannot be disappointed. You ever heard this phrase, don't ever meet your heroes? Some of you are laughing because you have, and you're like, yeah, disappointed. So I remember this from when I was a kid. Did anyone ever watch the show Extreme Home Makeover? Many of you have. So it's this show where there's a family or something tragic happened in their home, or they're financially in need and they need somebody to come in and fix it up. And here comes to the rescue Ty Pennington. He's the man. He's coming in and he's, what kind of house do you want? What can we do for you and your family? talks to the kids, what kind of bedroom do you want? I like Star Wars. Well, we're going to put a Death Star in your room. And it's like, wow, Ty Pennington is out here saving lives. He's out here making dreams come true. And you watch the show. Some of you already know where I'm going with this. So you watch the show and you're like, that guy is awesome. I want to know Ty Pennington. He seems like a great guy. And I'll never forget, I grew up in the suburbs of Philadelphia. There was one night, my parents went into the city with some of their friends for a nice dinner. And who do they see on the streets? Ty Pennington. Can you believe it? He's just there. And so they go up to talk to him. They want to talk to Ty Pennington. And I can't tell you exactly what he said. Because I don't remember, not because he said anything like profane, but they told me that he like totally ignored us. He tried to get us out of, like, he was a jerk. He was treating people like a jerk. Like, this guy is not nice to people. But do you see? Okay. In theory, Ty Pennington is great, but then when I have the personal interaction, not so great. But here's what I think happens in the church. I think that we can get confused and think that God, in theory, is great. And when I come to church and I sing songs, I know God is great. And church is great, and my community group is great, but when I get to be with God by myself, I'm going to be disappointed. Because then I have to deal with all this stuff in my life. I have to recognize all the things that are wrong about me. And it's just not going to be what I want it to be. It's just not going to be, because I've tried it before, and it's not this big emotional experience all the time. And I get it. But what is true about every time that you get alone and you get in quiet with God? Has he changed from the last time you were with him? Did he all of a sudden stop loving you? Did he all of a sudden stop working things out in your life? Did he all of a sudden stop caring about what you have to say? Or the things that you're feeling? Or the things that are hard in your life? Does he all of a sudden turn a blind eye to that? No, actually, the entire time, even if it's been so long you can't remember the last time you were alone with God, he's been attentive. He has been working on your behalf. He has been caring for you, even when you haven't been seeking him out. So how beautiful is it, that time that you're going to get before God and bear all of those things to him? To bear all of the things that I've messed up, to bear all of the things that I didn't have together, to bear all the times that I've rejected him, and to know that he's still going to love and care for me and receive me just as I am. How beautiful are those moments, and how great a reward that we did nothing to earn but just come and sit. Sit at the feet of our Father in heaven who loves and cares for us. When we pray, we need to see God for who he is. We need to remind ourselves of who he is, and we will not be disappointed. In verse 10, Jesus' prayer says this. It says, your kingdom come. God, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The second thing that Jesus wants us to see when we come before God in prayer, we see God for who he is, and we love God for how he works. So when we read these words, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I am asking God, I'm declaring to God, Lord, what you think is right, The way that you want things to work out here, the will that you have in your heavenly throne for this earth, exactly what you want is how I want it to be. Which means whatever you want me to do, I want to be a part of doing it. But that means that even all the things in my life that feel like they're not right, even the circumstances in my life that are really, really hard, God, I'm in it because you want it to be. And God, I know who you are. I know that you love me. I know that you are providentially working all things out in my life for my good. And so, Lord, for whatever I'm in right now, however you're working in my life right now, I know it's because you want it to be. And so, God, I love you that you would have me in this position, that somehow you would work this out for my good. And when we do not stop to have these moments with God and we recognize, Lord, you are working this out for my good. I do love you because you're working this out for my good. I do see you for who you are. Otherwise, the bitterness grows. If we don't have the time in the secret and we're going about doing our lives in a way that it seems like we love God, it seems like we're thrilled about all the things that we're doing, that he's doing, but really, I'm pretty upset. And I don't want to be in the secret because then I have to be upset with God. But what we find when we take the time to really process, to pray through all of the junk, to see God for who he is, and then take a real honest look at how all these things are in my life, all of my circumstances, and know that I don't like them as they are. But I know that God wants it to be this way. I can now love God even more, because he's taking this, and in this, his kingdom is coming, his will is done. And it's all for my ultimate eternal good. How beautiful is it to know that that is how God is working in our lives. And so we see God for who he is, we love God for how he works, and the last one, we trust God for what we need. Verse 11, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So there are three things that Jesus is praying about, to say you need to pray for these things that you need. And now I breezed through this before, but earlier on it says that God knows what we need before we ask him. Right? That's a crazy thought. So Jesus is telling me to pray for what I need. Very clearly, he's telling us to pray for what we need. And at the same time, he's saying, the Father knows what you need. So what happens when I pray for the things that I need before God? So here's the three things that he's talking about. He says, give us this day our daily bread, which is a overarching metaphor for all of your physical needs. I ask God to provide all of my physical needs. Why? If I'm not asking God to provide my physical needs, you know what happens? I start to think that I'm providing them. I start to think that my job provides my physical needs. I start to think that the way that I treat my spouse because it's good and it's right and I deserve to have a good marriage, that I'm providing it. Or I believe that whatever it is, I have whatever I have because I did it. But he says, no, the Father knows what you need, but ask him. Give us this day our daily bread, God, today. Give me what I need because I can't. If it were up to me, I would have nothing. God, you have given me everything. So, Lord, whatever it is that I need, would you give it to me? Forgive us our debts. What is Jesus asking us to pray for? He's asking us to pray for forgiveness. You certainly are not able to forgive your own sin. If you are, like, man, I'd be curious to know, because I don't know. I can't forgive my own sin. My sin is pretty unforgivable. Yet God forgives. And so what is there to be found in praying for forgiveness? Because we say, oh, but God forgives my sin anyway. He's already forgiven all of my sin because I'm saved. So why am I asking for forgiveness? But I'm telling you, when I come before God and I ask for forgiveness, especially forgiveness for things that I know should not really be forgiven, how beautiful is it to know God then? To know, yes, that sin shouldn't be forgiven, but it is. And then lastly, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Jesus asks us to pray to God for protection. And not just physical protection, spiritual protection. There's no hiding that there is a real enemy that exists to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to steal, kill, and destroy everything in your life, everything that is good. And there will be days that are unbearably hard. There will be entire seasons of life that are unbearably hard, where the enemy will think that he has you. Or you're going to think that you are under the dominion of the enemy. Satan is winning. But when you come before God and you know, my Father already knows what I need, and I ask him to protect me spiritually from the things that Satan is trying to do in my life, I know that he will. I know that he will. And so I will find, even though this is hard, I will find, even though I don't know when this battle is going to end, I know that my Father in heaven is going to protect me. He is going to keep me because that is who he is. And so, I think the gist of all of this is that we need the Lord. We need to be with him in prayer way more than we often think. We are not okay on our own. We are not okay going about life constantly hurried in just chaos of one thing to the next. We're not okay in that. Even if all the things are church things, we're not actually okay. We cannot be free. We cannot be confident in who God made us to be. We cannot be joyful in the midst of difficult circumstance without prayer. We need the Lord. We need his presence. We need to soak in who he is at every opportunity. The reward is so great. And the effort, so little. That why wouldn't we be spending as much time with him as we can? And so it's my encouragement to all of us, whatever you have going on this week, if you already have a schedule, revisit it. That you know without a doubt, I am not going to enter into all of these things without having time with my Lord and Savior. I am not going to go into these things without knowing that I'm going to sit at the feet of my Father in heaven and see him for who he is, love for the way that he works, and trust him for what I need. And so we're going to have the worship team come on up, and I'm going to take some time to pray. They're going to sing a song for us, but we're actually going to open up a little bit of time to sit and to pray, to forget about who else is in this room, to forget about whatever we're going to when this is over, and to know what I need more than anything else is that I need to be in God's presence. I need to bear myself before him and see him for who he is. And so I'm going to pray and give the Lord praise. Father, you're so great. Lord, there's no one like you. Search all the heavens, all the earth. God, we would not find someone who is like you. We would not find someone as powerful as you. We would not find someone as steadfast as you. We would not find someone as loving as you. We would not find someone as pure and righteous as you. God, you are perfect in all of your ways. And so, Lord, I just thank you that you have revealed yourself to us. What an honor, what a gift it is that we get to know you, that we get to know our Creator. To know that you designed us intricately with great purpose and intention, that nothing in us is a mistake, because, Lord, you designed us. You know every hair on our head. You know every thought that we have. God, I thank you for how involved you are in our lives. I thank you that everything we have is by the work of your hand. That every circumstance in our lives is a sign of your love. Lord, I thank you for who you are, and I thank you that you have made yourself available to us, that we can come to you at any time with anything, and you hear us. And so, Father, we give this moment to you. Lord, would your Spirit speak to each one of us? Lord, would we know in the very depth of our inner being that you are there? That you are working, that you love us. Lord, we need you. And so we give this time to you. This moment is set apart to spend time with you. So God, would you meet us? In Jesus' name.
And I the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
So church, we're going to give you this time right now. We're going to take a few minutes. We're not going to sing. We'll play softly underneath you. Take this time and pray. Let's go and meet with the Lord. Says to come to him, those who are heavy laden. If there's anything pressing on your heart right now, bring it to the Lord. He can carry it. He really can. As I said earlier, if there's any fear or doubt in your life, if you're even questioning God, are you really there? He can handle it. Bring it to the Lord. Some sin in your life. runs deep. Your grace is more, where grace is found, is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Loved. Have a great day.